BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
The ancient Hebrew scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing. Turn to the book of Exodus, Shemot, Exodus chapter 11. Exodus chapter 11. This is message E284, Parash number 15. It is called Bow. It is from the book of Shemot, Exodus chapter 10 through chapter 13. We're doing Parash number 15, Bow. It means go. We're going to start off in Shemot 11, Exodus 11, verse 4 and 5. Verse 4 and 5. Okay, Exodus 11, Shemot 11, verse 4 and 5. Once again, if you're listening or watching this on live stream or YouTube, you could download from the Google Store our application for, and just type in Beth Goyim Messianic, and then you can watch it on YouTube. And really have a good time with an easy application. Doesn't take much room on your phone. All right, so let's get down to the teaching. These teachings will be about an hour and 10 minutes. We try to end in an hour, but these parashas are just like too long. We try to give you an overview of what's going on in this particular parash. After we're done with this cycle, I've told you before, but you know, just in case, we have so many new people tuning in. They're on the website. They go up there on Wednesday. You can watch it on YouTube later on if you miss any part. But next cycle around, we're going to be switching to the 153 cycle. We're going to do a three-year cycle, break it down a lot smaller, which I want to really get into the deep profoundness of each and every. I mean, there's so much in each one of these things that we put in, and so much that we take out because there's just not enough time for each parash. If you love God, you really want to get deep into His Word. So Exodus 11, verse 4 and 5, Shemot 11, verse 4 and 5. Moshe said, "Here's what Yehovah says. About midnight, I will go out into Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt will die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh sitting at his throne, to the firstborn of the slave girl at the handmill, and all the firstborn of the livestock." Amen. I like the two pictures that we have there. It took me about 5 years to put together this whole Parash cycle, which you may download for free. Just please hit the doggone donate button if you're led. There are PDFs on our website. You can download the whole series. What I tried to do is, with each verse as much possible, get a picture that helps you start a discussion, helps to talk about the verse in pictures. And here we're talking about the firstborn dying. The one picture on the left, I think it really, even though it's cartoon, the man crying and holding a child is a really good depiction of what happened. There was not a home in all of Egypt that was not touched. The firstborn of every single home. Now, below that, I don't know if it's on the same slide for the tech department, there's a chart. Now, it says at midnight, about midnight, as we would know it from the movie, The Ten Commandments, the angel of death went out, and it said, the Lord says, about midnight, I will go out. It was the Lord, okay? What time, like, you know, in the Brit Hadashah, in the New Testament, you know, it was the first watch, it was the second watch. Well, what I did is give everybody what the watches are, okay? The first watch, the second watch, the third watch, the fourth watch, first hour, third hour, sixth hour, ninth hour. I gave you those, and what it correlates in our time frame. The first watch is sunset to 9 p.m. The second watch is 9 p.m. to midnight. Third watch, midnight to 3 a.m. So between the second and third watch is when, as we would know it, you know, through the movie, okay, it's not, you know, the angel of death. Okay, the angel of death went out into Egypt between the beginning at the second watch and going through to the third watch, because it says about midnight, okay? So that would be the second watch. The reason why that's important is when we go back into this part in the whole teaching tonight, you're going to see, you know, some things in the Brit Hadashah. It was the first watch. It was the second watch. It was the third watch in the night. Okay, or, you know, when Yeshua went to the cross on Hag Matzah, it was the first hour. It was the third hour. It was the sixth hour. So now you know when it says that with this chart, you can know what time of day it actually was. Going on to the next slide, we're now going to go back to Shemot 10, chapter 10, Exodus 10, verse 1 and 2. Shemot 10, verse 1 and 2. Yehovah said to Moshe, "Go to Pharaoh, for I have made him and his servants hard-hearted, so I can demonstrate these signs of mine among them, so that you can tell your son and grandson about what I did to Egypt and about my signs that I demonstrated among them, and so that you will all know that I am Yehovah." Amen. Why do we celebrate the holy days? Because we're supposed to remember what God did for us. Okay? That's the key to all the holy days. See, when you really remember what he did and respect what he did to another grouping of people, and he saved us, then when you go to do something stupid that breaks the commandments, you might think twice about doing it. So God is saying here, Jehovah is saying here, tell your son, your grandson, what I did. Don't ever forget it, because once we become complacent meaning, you know, yeah, and that's the way it was as a kid. You know, the Passover had gotten so boring, you know, and you know, the adults, as I was talking to my wife last night, really where America and the world began to fall, the worst generation was my parents' generation. They absolutely, totally destroyed following God, okay? So we got to, you know, plague one, so we dip our finger in the wine and put it on a napkin. You know, like I really care, okay? But Jehovah's saying, don't do that to me. I did this to bring you unto myself, to demonstrate to them that you know that I am Yehovah, okay? So here, now we're focusing on harden. Now we've been, over the last week or two, we've been talking about the plagues. Now, Jehovah didn't say to Moshe how many plagues there was going to be when he first said, I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. But then after the two plagues, he did give Pharaoh an opportunity to repent. Okay, but Pharaoh said, psh, I'm not going to do that, which many people do. So now it is at the end of this where the Lord say, okay, I've had enough of you people. I'm going to harden your heart. I'm going to destroy you now. So the word hardened is kabed or kabad. All depends which way you want to say it, from Ashkenazi or Sephardic. It means to be heavy, be weighty, be grievous, be honorable, be glorious, be burdensome, be honored, be insensible, be dull, make unresponsive. Okay, now it's a very interesting word because in Hebrew, it has to be read in context for you to know what it means, because honorable and unresponsive are two really different words. So you must read it in context. So here, if we go back to verse 1, Jehovah said to Moshe, go to Pharaoh, for I have made him and his servants hard-hearted, kabed. Okay, so he's making them respectable? No. He's making them hard-hearted. He's making them unresponsive. Okay? So he's going to be unresponsive to all the signs and wonders that are going on around him. And then he's going to do a very tremendous thing. And it's going to cause a lot of people pain and suffering. This is why, people need to be involved in their governments to the highest level. Because when the government, when the leaders fail, everybody suffers. Pharaoh failed, so everybody in Egypt had lost this that night. Okay, on the Feast of Hag Matzah, everybody in Egypt had suffering because Pharaoh was a jerk and he wouldn't yield to God. So now, we need to do the same thing. So in whatever country you're listening to this teaching in, and we have, I think, 173 or 74 nations listening in now, okay? Wherever you are, pray for your leadership that God would speak to them, that God would soften their hearts. Okay, now why is this important, the signs and wonders? Hold your place there in Shemot. Turn to Matthew 16, verse 3. Now with understanding of signs, now you can go to the Brit Hadashah since it's one book. You have to know the beginning so that you can know the second half of the story, of the account anyway. Matthew 16, verse 3. Matthew 16, verse 3. And in the morning you say, storm today, because the sky is red and overcast. You know how to read the appearance of the sky, but you can't read the signs of the times. Amen? So this is good for anybody, if you're going fishing or whatever. Red sky in the morning, sailor's warning. Red sky at night, sailor's delight. Okay? Red sky in the morning, sailor's warning. Red sky at night, sailor's delight. That's what Yeshua just said. Red sky in the morning, storm today. Okay? So, signs. Once you start seeing signs and wonders, what I highly recommend to those in America, start reading the book of Jeremiah, the prophet Jeremiah. Okay? It is quite amazing. It's going to be part of our message tomorrow, 6:28. Okay? So, once you start seeing signs, you're like, okay, Lord does nothing in secret. The Father does nothing in secret. You're like, okay, that's happening. That's happening. Now, the same goes for studying the book of Exodus. So it really ties very heavily, as we've been saying over the last few weeks, into the book of Revelation. All right, going on to the next slide. Go back to Exodus 10. We're going to look at verse 3 now. Shemot 10, verse 3. Shemot 10, verse 3, Moshe and Aaron went into Pharaoh and said to him, here's what Yehovah, the Elohim of the Hebrews, says. How much longer will you refuse to submit to me? Let my people go so they can worship me. Amen? So here, the key words that we're focusing in and the phrase that we're focusing in on very heavily for this particular verse is submit to me. People hate to submit. People hate to submit to authority, any type of authority, because we're rebellious people. The people in the world today are a rebellious group of people. Okay? So Pharaoh, but it's nothing new. Pharaoh was not submitting to God. So Moshe and Aaron, why do you have both of them? Because you need the two witnesses. It's part of Torah. Even though Torah is not written on parchment at this point, you need the two witnesses because God always keeps his commitments. Okay, he follows Torah from the very beginning of time. So Moshe and Aaron went in and said to him, submit to God. The picture is very interesting because you have these two men fighting. And you got the one guy putting the other guy into what's affectionately called a sleeper hold. So cutting the blood flow to the guy's brain pretty soon after you do that for long enough, it will cause the guy to pass out. So here, the big guy's like, yeah, submit to me. Same as with the Lord. He's saying, I don't want to do this. This is terms of peace. He's saying, submit to me and just let the people go. I mean, it's amazing how Pharaoh, didn't see all these signs and wonders. It touched his nation. It shows he didn't care about what was going on to the people because he still ate. He still did this. He still did that. He had a little, problems with the people, whatever. Okay, submitting to God. We had an army. Let the people go, and if they run away, you got a pretty big army. You can chase down a bunch of slaves. and catch them. But he didn't want to submit to God. He did not want to submit to God. So submitting and humbling ourselves to God is always a key to a walk with the King of Kings. Now hold your place there in Shemot 10 and go to the book of James, Yaakov. James chapter 4. This is why here at this ministry, and a lot of ministries don't do this, and I don't know why, basically it's stupidity. You know, we are 100% legalistic because God the Father is legalistic, and so is Yeshua. Okay? You got to submit to God. The Father would never give you something bad, and if you believe that we don't have to do these things anymore, well then, you're just misled by the devil, and nice knowing you. James 4, verse 7 through 9, 7 through 10. The key here is submit and humble. Therefore, submit to God. Moreover, take a stand against the adversary, and he will flee from you. Come close to Elohim, and he will come close to you. Clean your hands, sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded people. Wail, mourn, sob. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy into gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Amen? So there we see submitting to God. This is in the Brit Hadashah. Okay? The New Testament's not written for everybody to read. You know, the Galatians are not reading the Ephesians letter. The Romans are not reading the Galatians letter. Nobody's reading Revelation because it's not written yet. So here, submitting to God would be what? That would be basically following the Torah. Okay? Come close to God. It means that you follow his commandments. Not just the ones you like, but all of them. When you do that, you're taking a stand against the adversary. If you don't want to grow your beard, you don't want to cover your head, ladies, if you're married, you don't want to wear the tzitzit on the outside of your pants, you want to put them in a belt loop, the tzitzit, and set it on a four-corner garment, you're not taking a stand against the adversary because he's going to be able to say, well, at your trial, the adversary is going to be called as a witness against you, and he's going to say, well, you know, Joe Blow here wore the tzitzit inside his pants because he was afraid what anybody would think. No, you're not getting into heaven because you're open in disobedience. Submitting to God means submitting to what he says. Okay? Growing a beard long, not cutting the sides, not cutting even your lip. You know, sometimes you eat it. Yes, you do. Cutting the hair on your lip. But I'm going to eat it. I'm going to trim it. Well, you're going to have to answer to God. What do you think God's going to say? Okay? He said, don't cut it. You know? Humble yourselves before the Lord in verse 10. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. Humbleness means following his commandments. You know, not just the ones you like, but as many as you can possibly remember. But studying, because God says the law's in your heart, okay? And it's on paper, and Yeshua gave us as an example. So submitting and humble yourselves, being raised up. Pharaoh didn't submit, he didn't humble himself, he was destroyed. So you have the choice to make for yourself because the parochet, the curtain, has ripped and put you in charge of you. Going on to the next slide. Going back to Shemot 10, verse 6, please. Shemot 10, verse 6. They will fill your houses, and those are your servants and all the Egyptians, make nothing your fathers and your fathers have ever seen since the day they were born until today. Then he turned his back and left. We're not so much focusing on the plague with this particular part, but what we are focusing on is the last part of the sentence, is then he turned his back and left. Okay? Some people turn their back on God. Okay? Some people do not listen to God. Some people won't submit to God. Some people don't want to hear the word of God. They want to listen to anything else, gossip or whatever is neat, whatever it is, they'll listen to anything else, but they will always turn their back on God. They will turn their back on reading the word, turn their back on listening to proper teachings. You know, if you're listening to a teacher, and there's unfortunately, there's many teachers on the net now today. Read their statement of faith. On our website is our statement of faith. It is very long. I've been told it's the longest Messianic statement of faith on the web from people I knew at the Messianic Times. Why is it? I want you to know about this ministry. I want you to know what we think. I want you to know what we follow, what we teach. And when somebody doesn't have a detailed statement of faith, then you really don't want to listen to them. If they don't tell you where they've been trained, well, I've just been studying the Word for 20 years. You know nothing. You know, and that is evident in the book of Nehemiah, Ezra, okay? You see Nehemiah is doing things wrong, and the people just fail. Okay, Ezra comes along and reads the Torah, and everybody's like, oh, I never heard of it. Okay, so here, but a lot of people turn their back on strong teachings because they don't want to hear it. Okay, Pharaoh didn't want to hear the teaching, so he just kept turning his back on God. Now with that, turning your back on God, hold your place there, turn to the Gospel of Matthew, please. Matthew 10. Matthew 10, verse 13 through 15. Matthew 10, verse 13 through 15. We're focusing on turning your back and leaving. Matthew 10, verse 13 through 15. If some home deserves it, let your shalom rest on it. If not, let your shalom return to you. But if the people of a house or town will not welcome you or listen to you, leave it and shake its dust from your feet. Yes, I tell you, it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the people of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Amen? So what Yeshua is talking about here is turn your back and leave. They don't want to receive the word. Take your shoes off, clap them together and say, I'm done with you. You're like the dust on my feet. You're nothing. Okay? Well, that's not very nice, Yeshua, saying something like that. How are you going to win people to the kingdom? Who am I to tell Yeshua that he's wrong? Okay? But Yeshua, you know, when I hear a lot of New Testament-only followers, you know, whether they be a Jew or a Gentile, you know, they're saying, well, you don't show enough love. I've been told that, like, time and time again. Well, Yeshua's saying, if they don't want to listen, you know, to the truth, that this is the way you're supposed to follow God. You know, I have lots of family that I don't have anymore. Why? Because they died in the Holocaust. And it was all disobedience to God. Why did the Holocaust happen? Hitler was a terrible fighter. He got injured in World War I. A terrible artist. He got kicked out of school. Got arrested a whole bunch of times for sedition. And there was no way that this guy should have been raised up to where he was. He was a dork. Okay? A goofy looking man, couldn't really grow a mustache, and he wasn't an exceptional military person, but why was he so anointed? Because God used him from that time, because the people of Israel, the Jews in Germany, tried to appease the German government, the Nazi party, and then they died. Why? Because they didn't want to submit to God. So here, Yeshua is saying the same thing. Once you try to tell them, you've done your best, take your shoes off, clap, say, I'm done with you. And let the devil take care of these people. And Yeshua says in verse 15, yes, I tell you, it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the people of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Because the people of Sodom and Gomorrah had basically one basic sin themselves. But they... why is it going to be more tolerable for them than for the ones that won't hear the word? Oh, that would be blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. Going on to the next slide. Going back to Exodus 10, verse 14 and 15. The locusts went up over all the land of Egypt and settled throughout Egypt's territory. It was an invasion more severe than had ever been before or will ever be again. It completely covered the ground so that the ground looked black. They ate every plant growing on the ground and all the fruit and the trees and left by the hail. Not one green thing remained, not a tree, not a plant in the field in the land of Egypt. Amen? The picture you're seeing there on the slide, that's an actual real picture of locusts. Okay? Now, what the person, I think it's a young boy, is doing, he's catching them to eat them. One of the things that locusts do, because they are kosher, they do have a jointed leg. A jointed leg means it looks like your finger. It's a joint, okay? Not a joint that you smoke and get high with, a joint type of leg. They have a lot of protein. Actually, the Lord was being sort of nice. He was destroying the land, but also giving the people something to eat. Maybe not something that they liked. Maybe, you know, it might have been the heart. One of those little legs got stuck in your teeth again. But he was giving them protein and food to eat that would keep them alive. He was not destroying them totally. But the locusts came and ate up everything. Now, why is that important to know? Because we're going to go to the book of Revelation in a minute. But this is the eighth plague. It's called Arba. It means locusts. Okay, locusts. Some of the earlier plagues have been separated by extended intervals. Some of the writers write, but the eighth plague followed immediately the heels of the seventh. Okay, locusts came upon the land. Every twig, every plant, every green thing was eaten. Done. Completed. And have you ever seen a locust eat? Just, wow. The thing is like an eating machine. Okay? Now, this was something against a couple of gods of Egypt. This was was against Nepri, the grain god of Egypt. Armutet, the goddess of childbirth of the crops. Anubis. I like Anubis. And the jackal-headed guardian of the field. Lots of gods in Egypt, just like in India today. Lots of gods. And so the Lord was saying, your God's nothing. I'm going to send this so much so it's going to cover the ground and make it look black. That's a lot of locusts. You know, Egypt's a pretty big place, and it's a bunch of sand. And that's to make sand look black. But it would give them a lot of food to eat. Now, why is that important? Understanding that it's against the grain god, childbirth and crop god, and guardian of the field. Why is that important? These three gods. Now, with that information, hold your place. Turn to Revelation 9. Revelation 9, verse... Well, it's a big reading. All right, we're going to read the whole thing. Revelation 9, verse 1 through 10. The reason we're doing this is because I think a lot of this may begin in our lives. So once you see the one step, you're going to know what's going to follow. Because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change, nor does his pattern. Revelation 9, verse 1 through 10. The fifth angel sounded the shofar, and I saw a star that had fallen out of heaven onto the earth, and was given the key to the shaft leading down to the abyss. He opened the shaft of the abyss, and there went up smoke from the shaft like the smoke of a huge furnace. The sun was dark in the sky too, the smoke from the shaft. Then out of the smoke into the earth came locusts, and they were given power, like the power of scorpions have on earth. They were instructed not to harm the grass on the earth, or any green plant or any tree, but only the people who did not have the seal of God on their foreheads. Locusts were not allowed to kill them, only to inflict pain on them for 5 months. And the pain they caused was like the pain of a scorpion sting. In those days, people will seek death, but will not find it. They will long to die, but death will elude them. Now, the locusts looked like horses outfitted for battle. Their heads were what looked like crowns of gold, and their faces were like human faces. They had hair like woman's hair, and their teeth were like those of lions. Their chests were like iron breastplates, and the sound of their wings made like a roar of many horses and chariots rushing into battle. They had tails like those of scorpions with stings, and their tails were their power to hurt people for 5 months. Amen? So in that passage, you see that it's going to hurt people for 5 months. A scorpion sting basically incapacitates you. The scorpion sting basically keeps the prey alive. It keeps the heart going and the breathing happening, but the person or the prey can't move. Okay? So it's like you want to die. You're being eaten. You can feel yourself like the bug, you know, that's stung by the scorpion. You know, it's just frozen there, but it's alive. So it's getting eaten by the scorpion, but it can't do anything to stop it. And it burn. Okay? So imagine your leg getting eaten. You're paralyzed. You can't get up. You can't move. You're still breathing. You can feel everything. But that's how angry God is. because we're not following the word. Because we have teachers out there saying you don't have to follow the law. It's, you know, you don't show enough grace. Well, my God says, do what I say. Don't harden your heart. Okay? So here, now you understand what the scorpion is. The locusts, they look like locusts. They're going to be massive. They're going to be everywhere. Okay? Black like the ground. They're going to be eating up everything except what the Lord says, don't touch that stuff. But if you have the mark of God on your head, why does it say the head? Okay? On their foreheads, the seal of God on the foreheads. Because what is on the high priest's garment? What's on his mitre? There's a thing of gold with a blue thread that goes around the head. It says, Kadosh La Yehovah. Okay? Holy unto the Lord. Is your mind holy unto the Lord? And you say, I'm just covered in the blood of Jesus. You're not holy. You're an idiot. Okay? Okay? So I'm sorry if that sounds harsh, or, you know, you shouldn't call people idiots. Well, the Lord called the five virgins morons. So I'm following after my Lord because I love Yeshua and I pattern my life again about him. We're at the point of disaster because you don't have teachers standing up and being firm in the Word of God. You know, that a couple of weeks ago we saw two pastors in England arrested because they said in street preaching that, you know, there's only one way to heaven, and that's through, they called him Jesus. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and life. You know, they were convicted this week in England. We're at the party's beginning, people. Get ready for a fight and get your battle armor on. Us Jews understand that because we study the book of Esther. We know that it's coming. Going on to the next slide. Back to Exodus 10, verse 21. Exodus 10, Shemot 10. Hopefully you're learning something here. I think it's pretty interesting type of stuff. Let me just see what this message is here. Exodus 10, verse 21. Exodus 10, verse 21. Yehovah said to Moses, reach out your hand toward the sky, and there will be darkness over the land. A darkness so thick, it can be felt. Amen? That's kind of weird, don't you think? What would be darkness? You know, when I first started to really study the scriptures, like, what does it mean, darkness that can be felt? Okay, well, first, let's take a look at the God that is going. This is the ninth plague. Okay, darkness was the Ra, the sun god. If you've seen the movie Mummy, or I think Mummy 2 also it's in, that's the god, the guy with the thing on his head. It's if you're looking at the picture there, that's the god Ra. It's in the movie Mummy, so they're trying to promote these gods and how powerful they are and things like that, okay? The Egyptian plaque depicts a supreme god, Amon-Ra. Amon-Ra, performing secret rituals as god of the air, okay, associated with the breath of life. So here this darkness is surrounding you. So here God is saying, where is your god that's the god of the air? Where is your god that's the breath of life? But you got darkness all around you, okay? So here that it's like a sundial on top of his head there. It's a snake, but it's supposed to be the sun. If you're looking at the picture there, okay, darkness. So much it can be felt like it's surrounding you. It's encompassing you. If you've ever seen somebody who's depressed, really, really, really depressed, the darkness surrounds their life. Okay, they can't see any goodness. They can't. You can beat me up, you can do whatever you want, okay? So it's darkness surrounds their life. Now, why is that important? Hold your place there. Turn to Revelation 16 now. Revelation 16, verse 10 and 11. Revelation 16, verse 10 and 11. The fifth one poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and its kingdom grew dark. People gnawed on their tongues from the pain. Yet they cursed the God of heaven because their pain and sores. It did not turn from their sinful deeds. Amen? This is also, once again, following the submission. Okay? God does a plague, and instead of the people going, oh, maybe we did something wrong, sorry, God, they hate God. This shows something that's quite amazing because we're seeing this in the world today. This shows a knowledge of God, but a hatred towards that knowledge. See, everybody knows God. Everybody knows the Torah. It's in our hearts. Okay? From the time Adam bit that fruit, all knowledge of good and evil has been in every person. Okay? So it grew dark. So here it's a darkness right before the death. Okay? So these people in Revelation 16 get pain and sores, and they hate God even more instead of turning. God chastises those he loves. He wants you turning to him. So he's not going to give you riches for you to turn to him many times. Many times for people, he has to take things away. He starts with, a lot of times with small things for most people. And then he works his way up trying to get your attention because he doesn't want you to die in your sin. The same even here in Revelation 16. We're into the fifth bowl judgment. That means there's been seven seals, seven shofars. So that's 14. 15, 16, 17, 18. This is the 19th plague. The 19th plague. And people are still not getting it. But they know that there's God. Okay? Look at verse 11. He cursed God of heaven because of their pain and sores and did not turn from their sinful deeds. God was trying to get your attention. 19th plague, but you don't want to do it. So God doesn't want you to die in your sin, so he's going to cause you pain so you might turn from him. That's the real good thing about sickness. It gives you an opportunity to get right with God. Well, you know, you see a flash and boom, you're blown up. It's over. Your fate is now sealed. A sickness or a famine is a beautiful thing in one regard, that you have the opportunity to repent before death comes. Let me say that again, because a lot of people don't teach this and a lot of people don't understand it. Cancer is like a good thing to some people because you're taken apart slowly but surely. You feel sick. You got a lot of time to retrospect. You got a lot of time to read. And because, you know, you're incapacitated, God's saying, turn to me, child, before I call you back home. And you have a trial and the trial's going to turn out bad. And I'm going to have to say, go to hell. Okay, I don't want to do that, but I will tell you to your face, says Yeshua. Now turn to Jude also. Now Jude 1. Jude 1, verse 6 through 13. 6, verse 6 and verse 13. Jude 1, we're going to read verse 6 and verse 13. Jude 1. And the angels that did not keep within their original authority, but abandoned their proper sphere, he has kept in darkness, and bound for an everlasting chain for the judgment of the great day. Amen. So verse 6, these angels that came against God, he trusted them. Now he's going to put them, you know, why does he put them in darkness? Because they were living with the light. Yeshua was the light. They came against the Father and his Son. So now you get to stay in darkness, so dark that it can be felt. Because you went against God, he's going to put you in that place. Now look at verse 13. Savage sea waves heaving forth their shameful deeds like foam. Wandering stars from whom the blackest, darkest darkness has been reserved forever. Okay? So once you understand the plague of Egypt, you now understand what Yehuda, Jude, is saying. That if you're an angel, even if you are close to God and you come against him, he's going to put you in a place. Now, a lot of people, like atheists, have read, well, that's not a very nice guy. God, that God you serve is narcissistic. He can be. If God wants to be narcissistic, let him be. Can you make light? Can you make the universe? Can you speak the universe? Let there be light, and there becomes the universe. You know, all the planets are circled. Do you think that happened with an explosion? You're smoking a little bit too much reefer. You might be doing LSD at this point. You know, if you really think that that's true, you got a lot more faith in your fake God than I got in my God. Okay? So here, God said, do these things, and you won't have the darkness surround you, but the light will surround you. Now going on to the next slide, go back to Exodus 10, verse 22 and 23. I'm going a little quick because there's a lot of stuff I want to try to get the whole parasha in, which we haven't done in a couple of weeks. And we haven't done this whole series. That's why I was like, sometimes I'm like, rabbis, what are you guys doing? Why are you putting so much? You know, there's some parts of the Bible where you can put a whole bunch in. There's great information, but this is like awesome information. Shemot 10, verse 22 and 23. Moshe reached out his hand toward the sky, and there was thick darkness in the entire land of Egypt for 3 days. People couldn't see each other, and no one went anywhere for 3 days. But all the people in Israel had light in their homes. Amen? So here you see the difference between those of God's chosen people and those of God's pagan people. The Gentiles, the pagans that were not following the way, and those that were separated for God's purposes. Now here we see the number three. Okay, three is for Elohim, the Father, Son, and the Spirit. As we see in Genesis 1, the word Elohim is primarily used in Genesis Bereshit 1. Okay, now here we see thick darkness in the entire land of Egypt. Okay, not just one part, not just Pharaoh's house. In the entire land of Egypt, it encompassed all these people, not for one day, not for 2 days, but for 3 days. Okay, 3 days the people didn't go anywhere, couldn't see each other. It's basically like being in the grave. Oh, being in the grave for like 3 days. Oh, because when you don't want to follow the light, when God gives you an opportunity to choose the light, you don't worry, he's going to get your attention. Now, 3 days, what's important about the 3 days? Okay, let's go on to Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. We're going to look at verse 1 through 5. 1 through 5. We're going to do a couple of, actually just one reference. Cut it down on this teaching. Joel chapter 2, verse 1 through 5. I'll give you a second to find that. Prophet Joel. Joel chapter 2, verse 1 through 5. Blow a shofar in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let the living in the land tremble, for the day of Jehovah is coming. It is upon us. A day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick fog, a great and mighty horde is spreading like blackness over the mountains. There has never been anything like it, nor will there ever be again. Not even after the years of many generations. Ahead of them a fire devours, behind them a flame consumes. Ahead of them the land is like gone to them, behind them a desert waste. From them there is no escape. They look like horses and like cavalry. They charge with a rumble like that of chariots. They leap over mountains like crackling flames, devouring someone like the mighty horde in a battle array. Amen? Now, if you study Exodus and you study Revelation, you can understand what's going on. You understand the prophet, a great day of darkness, a horde is covering. What did it say in Exodus? Shemot, about so many locusts, it was covering the ground. Covering the ground. Now, this is a great day of darkness and gloom. And when you read chapter 1, it's really terrible. A lot of people like to, you know, Christians and a lot of New Testament only followers like to get to the part in chapter 2 where we're going to have dreams and visions and all this other fun stuff. You know, most of the church is always focusing on fleshly garbage. Okay? You know, yeah, that's nice stuff, but you got to live through chapter 1 and chapter 2. Okay? And chapter 2 here in the beginning is darkness and gloom. Great mighty horde over the land is spreading like blackness. You know, it looks like Gan Eden beforehand and a desert afterwards. But once you understand what the locusts did, and then once you understand the revelation, the scorpions stinging the people, and for 5 months, then this darkness that can be felt for 3 days, you hope it's only 3 days. For 5 months to be in total pain, for 5 months, I mean, you know, you're going to kill your liver by then because, you know, it says in Proverbs to give strong drink to somebody that's dying and in pain. So, you're going to be drinking for so long, you're going to kill your liver and everything else in your body, okay? Because you're going to try to get rid of that pain and you're not going to, okay? You're going to snort drugs, you're going to do drugs just to try to get rid of the pain. But the reason is because you're not doing your job. You're not following God the way he wants. So God says, here's my prophecy. Blow a shofar. Okay, and that's an alarm. Okay, so sound the shofar with a type of alarm. Okay, let all the living in the land tremble in verse 1. Okay, why all the land? Oh, the darkness was in all of Egypt. Now, once you understand the beginning, once you understand that concept of the hardening of your heart, you understand now what's going on in Yoel. So don't harden your heart to God's commandments. Embrace them and love them. Because in loving the commandments, you're loving Yeshua. In loving Yeshua, you're loving the Father. And when Dad's happy, you're happy. When Dad's angry, you're sad. So choose this day whom you're going to serve. It's that simple. Going on to the next slide. Go back to now to Exodus 11, verse 4 and 5. Exodus 11, we're now in chapter 11. We've got 25 more minutes to try to get to the rest of this. We might actually do it. Now, once again, if you miss any part of this, it's being recorded on YouTube right now, right, tech department? Okay? And it'll be on our website on this Wednesday, sometime in the afternoon, New York time. Okay? Exodus 11, verse 4 and 5. Moshe said, here's what Yehovah says, about midnight I will go out into Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt will die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh sitting on his throne to the firstborn of the slave girl at the handmill and all the firstborn of the livestock. Amen? So here, this is very interesting. Pharaoh, you can understand. You're like, well, he was a jerk and he wouldn't let the people of Israel go. But look at the end of verse 5. The firstborn of the slave girl at the handmill. What did she do? Well, see, when leadership is bad, you suffer. When evil rises, the people suffer. When good is in leadership, then the people prosper. Okay? So here, everybody in Egypt is going to testify that everybody, my neighbor's kid died, this kid died. That, imagine the suffering and the wailing that went on that night. And why God says, for the Pesach, keep it on this day. Don't forget what I did. All those other people, you know, how many people have lost loved ones, lost children? And there's always a hole in your heart. So imagine, you know, this is why the second commandment is so important. Your sin will be on the third to fourth generation. You know, you might be getting cursed, you know, from your grandchild or your great-grandchild because you didn't want to listen, because you didn't want to yield to God. Now your kid's suffering, your kid's a drug addict, your kid's a prostitute, your kid's whatever. You know, your kid gets hurt in a fight, loses an eye, whatever. So here, everybody suffered because Pharaoh would not yield to the Lord. That's why it's so important to only vote in the countries that you can vote for people that are godly. Okay? And if they say they're godly and they turn out to not be godly, remove them from office, recall them, you know, get rid of them. Because we must be accountable to God. And here, the handmaid. I mean, when I first read that, I was like, man, Lord, don't you think that was, you know, I'm talking to the Lord, I'm like, that sounds really serious. You know, and I was like, you know, show me. Because why would she have to suffer? She never met Pharaoh. She didn't vote for him. But this is how important community is. This is how important a remnant is. This is how important following Torah and Yeshua is. Because if there were 10 in Saddam, then both Saddam and Amorah, those people would have survived. There was only 6 that God counted as righteous. Only 6. So you needed the 4. You needed the light. So the same went here. Now, with that midnight, let's confirm what I said. We're going to look at 3 quick scriptures. They're all on the same slide. Turn to Psalm 119, please. Psalm 119, verse 62. What is this midnight thing? Is this when the witches come out? You know, from midnight to 3 is when I always heard, midnight to 3, the witches come out. Let's see what God thinks about midnight. What do you think? Psalm 119, verse 62. Psalm 119, verse 62. At midnight I shall rise to give thanks to you because of your righteous ordinances. Amen. So in the middle of the darkness, the middle of the night, I rise to give thanks. So if you got to get up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom, hey, give thanks to the Lord that you can still go. Thank to the Lord that you got a bathroom to go into. Okay? So here, Ezra is writing, at midnight, I rise because I'm alive. Oh, that's what he's saying. I know I was joking at first there. Okay? He's saying, because Ezra is a Torah teacher. He's a rabbi. I know a lot of people don't like us being called rabbi because they're too stupid to understand what Yeshua was talking about. You know, he's not really saying that, because he says, don't call any mother father. The fifth commandment says, honor mother father. So he's not getting rid of that. So Ezra, the rabbi, says, at midnight I shall rise to give thanks to you because of your righteous ordinances. I'm alive. With those who are dead in Egypt, I'm alive. I'm alive because I'm back from the diaspora. I'm back here in Jerusalem. I'm blessed. I'm going to rise in the middle of the night. You know, if my eyes will open up, I'm going to thank you because I'm alive. Because I could have been dead, as it was in like so many in Babylon. Esther, you know, Haman, that whole thing that we went through with Purim just a moment ago. Now look at Matthew 25, verse 6. Matthew 25, verse 6. Matthew 25, verse 6. Matthew 25, verse 6. But at midnight there was a shout, behold, the bridegroom, come out to meet him. Amen. This is the thing of the 10 virgins. 5 were smart and 5 were morons, Yeshua said. Okay? And when was it midnight? Midnight is the time of decision. Did you put the blood on your door? Well, we don't have to put the blood on the door anymore. Yeah, you do. You do, because it's a ceremony that must be kept. It marks your house, and it's a day that we'll, you know, we'll read it in a little bit if we get to it all. It's a day that God still watches over Israel. So we here at this congregation on our door, from the perfect lamb that we buy, we're confirming what Yeshua did that night. He put his blood on the door. It reminds me so much of the amazing, amazing event that happened on Hag Matzah. So we put the door on. We put the blood on our door. And I know there's a lot of idiots out there, and I know I'm using that word harshly again, but I really don't care. You know, people are looking for the barley. The barley, that's good. We do need the first fruit offering, and it is barley. But if you don't have hyssop, you can't do Pesach. So make sure you're on the right month. Okay, I know there's a lot of crappy teachers out there, a lot of men that have not been trained Messianic. They went from being pastors in the Christian church to sliding into, which is good. You know, it's a good journey. Like the Michael Roods and the Tim Hagues, you don't want to follow those guys. They're both not Jews. They're Gentiles. Hagues says his grandmother is a Jew. That makes him a Gentile. Okay? Okay? Your dad has to be. Read Genesis chapter 5. Read Yeshua's lineage. It's Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. Okay? Not Abraham, Rachel, and Leah. Okay? It's father. That's the seed. Okay, so about midnight, you make your choice. Those got up and followed Yeshua into the wedding feast. The other ones, oh, I'm out looking for oil. Hey, you got any oil? You got any oil? Hey, she's 22. You got any oil? Turn to Mark 13. Mark 13, this is an interesting one. I was like, wow, that's quite fascinating. And once you know the midnight reference, Mark 13, verse 35. Mark 13. It's quite a fascinating thing. Once you start putting the puzzle pieces together, like, wow. And there's so much that I didn't put into this. Now, if you also want the PowerPoint, if it's not there anymore, just send me an email at info@bethgoyim.org, info@bethgoyim.org, and I'll try to get you the PowerPoint if it's not there anymore. Mark 13, verse 35, therefore, be on alert, for you do not know when the master of the house is coming, whether in the evening, at midnight, when the rooster crows, or in the morning. Amen? So the master comes, you don't know. So it's times of day, midnight when you're supposed to be making the decision, did you put the blood on the door? Are you an Egyptian and a pagan Gentile? Or are you part of the house of Israel? Are you an Israelite or an engrafted in, one that follows the commandments, all of them, because there's one law for the Jew and the Gentile, because there's one God, one Messiah, one way of getting into heaven. Going on to the next slide. Okay, in the next slide, we see that the watch again. Okay, because in the beginning, I choose what is the main focus of the whole parash. Okay, once again, you see the chart, the first watch, the second watch, the third watch. Midnight is 9 p.m. to midnight is when it begins. So it's sort of like second watch, really third watch. Okay, because it's midnight to 3 a.m. So the second watch is ending at midnight. So you can sometimes you can count it, but it's more actually the third watch of the night. Okay, the fourth watch is when Yeshua was walking on the water. Okay, when you know the guys were in the boat and they're rolling, it's a ghost! And the whole thing with Kepha saying, tell me to come to you, Lord, was in the fourth watch. So it's 3 a.m., 3 a.m. to sunrise. Okay, so now with the firstborn dies, let's go to Revelation 1. Okay, we're talking about now the midnight, what's going to die, the firstborn. Revelation 1, verse 4 and 5. Revelation 1, verse 4 and 5. 15 minutes left of this teaching. 15-minute warning, fourth quarter. The Giants are down by 7. Revelation 1, verse 4 and 5. Revelation 1, verse 4 and 5. From Yochanan 2, the seven Messianic communities in the province of Asia. Grace and shalom to you from the one who is, who was, and who is coming. From the sevenfold spirit before his throne, and from Yeshua the Messiah, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the earth's kings. To him, the one who loves us, who has freed us from our sins at the cost of his blood. Amen. So here in verse 5, you see the firstborn. The firstborn had to give his life so that others may go free. Oh, let me say that again as I fix my tally. The firstborn had to give his life so that others may have freedom. It's a very interesting concept, and that's why Yochanan the Jew was writing this in the book of Revelation. Okay, the firstborn, okay, once you understand the loss in Egypt of all those firstborn, once you understand the firstborn giving his life to follow the ways of the Lord, once you understand Yeshua is the firstborn of the dead, the first one to rise, first one to go back up into heaven, once you understand all that, then you understand why Yochanan is writing what he did. It's a concept that you have to fully understand to understand what Yeshua did and why he did it. Because the firstborn son gets everything the father has if the father passes. Not that the father in heaven is ever going to pass, but he gets a double blessing too. Okay, moving on to the next slide. Go back to Exodus 11, Shemot 11, verse 7. Shemot 11, verse 7. Hopefully you're learning a lot in this parash. And once again, if you missed this, or if you want to get a little other parts of it, you go to, we have 5 years worth of this on our website, or 4 years. Okay? You go to Messianic Student, click on Parash Teaching, and it'll take you to the years. You can watch the other teachings. They are all in English only. Okay? Exodus 11, verse 7, Shemot 11, verse 7, but not even a dog growl will be heard against any of the people of Israel, neither against the people nor against the animals. In this way, you will realize that Yehovah distinguishes between Egyptians, the Gentiles, and Israel. Amen. I like that picture. You have the one person standing up top is distinguished above the rest of everybody else. As followers of Yeshua, okay, if you follow in spirit and truth, you're to be distinguished above and beyond anybody else because you serve the King. You are his child. Israel was the chosen people. They're the only chosen people on the planet. You can be part of that family if you leave your pagan Egyptian stuff, if you leave your Gentile life behind and become part of the true believers, the true followers of Yah. Okay? Yehovah distinguishes between us and everybody else. Okay? That's why I wear this beard proudly. That's why I wear the tzitzit. You know, I say every morning when after the prayer of putting on the talit, katan, I say before I put it on, I say, Lord, it's such an honor. I'm so blessed. I know I didn't like it as a child, but I wanted it now. Because once you realize and you live you try the things, the prodigal son, and you do all those crazy things, and once you get older, you're like, no, this is really what matters. And it's an honor to be distinguished as one of God's children. That's why we grow the beard. It's not to make us look handsome. Okay, actually, it makes us look a lot more gruffy. Okay? But it distinguishes us different. When a man shaves his face, it makes it look like a girl. Okay? Nice and clean and smooth. When you know, see all the advertisements for razors. Nice, smooth. Men's faces are not supposed to be smooth. Now, a woman's face is supposed to be smooth and beautiful. A man's face is supposed to be bearded, different, set apart. Okay? Distinguish between us and the rest of the world. And when you don't, you know, I can't grow a beard, what will people think? Well, then you're not really distinguished. So why don't you just leave following God and just go full into being secular. Enjoy this life, because hell's going to be I spent all my life and now I'm in hell. Well, distinguish. Now, if we look at the word distinguish, in the Hebrew it is pala, pei, lam, and hey, to be distinct, marked out, be separated, be distinguished. To be separated, be wonderful. Wow. Set apart. So when the Lord says Yehovah distinguishes, he says, I'm making you wonderful. So these beard, you know, if you're following in spirit and truth, anybody, you know, well, not anybody, can grow a beard. Okay? Some people can grow portions of beard, but whatever. That's still up to the Lord. Okay? But it makes us set apart for a higher purpose. It makes us look wonderful. Quite interesting. Now, with that understanding of the word distinguish, hold your place there in Exodus 11 and go to 1 John 3. 1 John 3. 1 John 3, verse 10. 1 John 3, verse 10. Empty. 1 John 3, verse 10. Here is how one can distinguish clearly between God's children and those of the adversary. Everyone who does not continue doing what is right is not from God. Likewise, anyone who fails to keep loving his brother is not from God. Amen? So, this is a powerful letter from Yochanan. Anyone who does not continue doing what is right is not from God. You're from the adversary. How will I know what is right and what is wrong? Oh, God was so merciful, so wonderful, so awesome. What did he do? He wrote it down. Eat this, don't eat that. What's the very first law ever given? A kosher law. Don't eat that. Okay? You can look at it, but don't eat it. Don't touch it. Gabish? I don't think you're speaking Italian, but I just like that word. Gabish? Okay. You got the point here. You hear what I'm saying? You know, if I just told you, don't even look at it, don't touch it, you give me such nachs. Okay? So here in 1 John 3:10, here's how one can distinguish clearly. How can you tell a true follower? Okay? One, if You're the person that you're listening to is on your teaching. And I know some of our early teachers. I've always had a beard from birth, you know. In the womb, I had a beard, you know. I came out with a full beard. No, I've been shaving since 10 or 11. It's been so long, okay. And, you know, and I had that chintzy mustache, like little Danny mustache Manny for a while, okay. So, but all boys do, but... Beard distinguished. So if you're listening to a teacher that doesn't have a beard, that means he's not following God. Man doesn't have tzitzit on the outside of his clothing that can be seen. He's not following God. He's following the adversary. Things to look at. Now, well, my pastor's a nice guy, and he doesn't have a beard, and, you know, there's a lot of Jews that don't follow God. You're right. You're absolutely right. But these are... And the book, the cover of the book doesn't really necessarily mean what's inside of it. But these are things that put red flags up. You know, does a guy have a beard? You know, Does he do this? Does he do that? Does he keep the Shabbat? Does he keep the seven holy days? These are red flags. What is distinguished? Okay? Preaching the commandments. Yeshua never said stop him. Matthew. And when he said it's finished on the cross, he didn't mean the law, you twit. He said his job. I'm done. I did it. I'm going home. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. I'm done. I'm going home. Curtain rip. Your job now. Here's the ball. Here's the ball. Who wants the ball? Okay. Go back to now Exodus. You getting anything? All right. You learning something? You learning something? You learning something? You learning something? I didn't go over this in theology. I didn't get to all this. Exodus 12 now. This is going to confuse everybody because the Jews confuse people with Rosh Hashanah. Now, I want to show you the real Rosh Hashanah. Rosh mean, you know, head. Rosh Hashanah, the head of the year. Exodus 12, verse 1 and 2. It's not very hard, but people get confused. Yehovah spoke to Moshe and Aaron in the land of Mitzrayim, Egypt. He said, you are to begin your calendar with this month. It will be the first month of the year for you. Okay, now people say, well, it's Rosh Hashanah in the seventh month. One is lower than seven. I know you might have that new math, the common core math, but God said, and in the Hebrew it says, Rosh Chodesh Chodeshim, the head of the month, the beginning of the year, when the year changes, and so you can go with each year. I don't get into this. I use the what they're using in Israel, 5778. Okay, some people are in 6,000, whatever. It doesn't matter a hill of beans. But the year changes at Passover, not in the seventh month. Very clear here, it'll be the first month of the year for you. And if you can't follow that, it's when you do Passover. It's not that hard to understand, but people confuse themselves. Okay, just read the word, it's not that hard. Okay, going on to the next slide. Let's go to verse 6 and 7. You are to keep it until the 14th day of the month, when the entire assembly of the community of Israel will slaughter it at dusk. You are to take some of the blood and smear it on the two sides and top of the door frame at the entrance of the house which they were going to eat it. Amen? Is the circle on that slide, Tristan? Is there a horizon? Go to the next slide if you're on the tech department. Okay? Okay. It says you're to slaughter it at dusk. So the 14th begins the day before, and that you're ending the 14th day for Pesach. Some people get this confused. Okay, now in the slide there, you see the beginning of dusk is what basically when the sun touches the horizon, wherever you are, that is dusk. So when you if you're by the ocean, and you hear the sun touches the ocean, and it goes. Then you know that's dusk, okay? That's the beginning of dusk. So when it touches that circle, it's cool because when the circle touches the square. Now, the circle touches the horizon, okay? You take this, the circle, and it touches the horizon. That simple understanding is that is the beginning of dusk, okay? Dusk is the end of the day. Dawn is the beginning of the day. I know some children have a hard time understanding that, okay? So dusk is the end of the day. That is when, if you're living in community and you have an altar, oh, you can't have an altar anymore. Why not? Okay, so if you have a lamb, okay, and you know how to do this stuff, this does take some skill to cut cut a lamb, you know, get the stuff out, get the hair off, all this other fun stuff, so that you can eat it during the Pesach, okay? That lasts, Pesach lasts approximately 90 minutes from dusk until complete darkness. Okay? And in verse 7, it says they are to take some of the blood and smear it on the two sides and the top of the door frame, they enter the house which they will eat it. So we do a community, a congregation Pesach. So we take the blood of the lamb that we got, a perfect lamb. We pick the best lamb we possibly can. Right, Ravan? We looked in. Can you open his mouth? The guy's like, why? Want to see his teeth? Why? Don't ask. Just please do it. Now, I know this year, don't get a real fat one. One that's got a real fat tummy at the moment, because you're not going to eat the stomach, and you just paid, you know, for like 30 pounds of stuff that's in his tummy. I was like, man, look at all that. We just paid for all that? Jiminy crickets. Okay? So, now, you are to put the blood on your door. You are to put the blood on the door. Go on to the next slide. Verse 14. This will be the day for you to remember and celebrate as a festival to Yehovah. From generation to generation, you are to celebrate in a perpetual regulation. Okay, you are to do this forever. Okay, not until the cross. It doesn't say until the cross. It says for a perpetual regulation. In that picture, that is a very good depiction of the Pesach. They would be sitting on the floor. You're in an upper room in a Middle Eastern home during the first century. One, it might not be super hot, but it's still going to be a little bit warm. It's not like the Da Vinci painting where they got dinner rolls or sitting on benches. All right, they're going to be sitting on the floor, okay, in a reclining position. All right? Now, Oyam means forever. Doesn't mean to stop. Okay? I'm going to do a little quicker. I want to get the whole thing in here. Verse 17, Exodus 12, verse 17. Now, next slide. Which says, always love is always and forever. You observe this festival of matzah. For this very day I brought your divisions out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, you are to observe this day from generation to generation by a perpetual regulation. Amen? So the Lord says it a second time. So if you didn't get it the first time, when he says something a second time, do it. And this is why Yeshua says, do this in memory of me. Okay? Do what? Drink wine, eat bread. Well, the church, we do this once a month. We do the Santa Cena in Spanish. We do the communion. No, you dingbat, you're not supposed to do that. He wants us to be special. This is the day he went to the cross. It's Hag Matzah, because Passover is only 90 minutes. He wants you to remember this day. And then the way you always know that you're on the right one is because you sight the moon. You'll know you'll be on the perfect day. Don't do it by calendar. Do it by moon. Sight the moon, the first banana. Boom. Then you know this is the day. I love that day. I just really love that day. I give such thanks to Yeshua and the Father for sending him for that day. Because I didn't have to worry about the rabbis anymore. It's all on me. Going on to the next slide. Exodus 12, verse 37 and 38. This is a very important slide. The people of Israel traveled from Ramesses to Sukkot, some 600,000 men on foot, not counting children. A mixed crowd also went up with them, as well as livestock, large numbers, both flocks and herds. Amen? Verse 38 is a very important thing because the rabbis don't teach us. They never taught me this in yeshiva. When I read it, I'm like, what's this mixed crowd? That were the Gentiles that put the blood on the door. The other slaves. The mixed crowd went up with them. And the mixed crowd also received Torah in Exodus 20. It's a mixed crowd. Don't let anybody tell you that it's not Jews and Gentiles being set free. That's why Jews and Gentiles still do the Pesach together as one people following the law. Skip the next slide. Verse 42. Exodus 12, verse 42. This was the night when Yehovah kept vigil to bring them out of the land of Egypt. And the same night continues to be a night when Yehovah keeps vigil for all the people of Israel throughout all their generations. Amen? So this Pesach, he's going to still do the same thing because God never breaks his word. So if you're not doing it, he's saying, there's that guy over there and that guy over there and that guy over there. No, they're not doing it. And they're not having lamb. Well, we couldn't find lamb. Did you try? We couldn't afford a lamb. Did you try? You would have put $5 a week away, or even $2 a week, or $3 a week, you'd be able to get a lamb. So if you're not doing lamb, God is keeping watch. Going on to the next slide. Verse 43 and 44. 12, verse 43, verse 44. Yehovah said to Moshe, and Aaron, this is the regulation of the Pesach lamb, no foreigners eat it. But if anyone has a slave you bought for money, when you have circumcised him, he may eat it. Amen? Any man who is uncircumcised, that is doing the Passover, that is eating of the lamb, He's going to hell if he's uncircumcised. Open disobedience gets you a ticket to hell. And Yeshua bought us for the 30 pieces of silver. Skip the next slide. Go to verse 40. Exodus 12, 4, verse 48 is our last slide. Last thing I'm going to talk about tonight. Exodus 12, verse 48. If a foreigner staying with you wants to observe Yehovah's Pesach, all his males must be circumcised. Then he may take part and observe it. He'll be like a citizen of the land, but no uncircumcised person is to eat it. Amen? You know, I like the guys, you know, they always say, well, you know, we got to have circumcision of heart. That's really what matters. If you have circumcision of heart, you're going to be following the commandments, you dingbat. And God said, you got to be circumcised, eat of the Pesach. Yeshua said, do this in memory of me. And if you don't do that, then you might as well go out and party. You might as well go snort cocaine. Do whatever makes you real happy in the world. Because you're not going to get into my Father's house. Because no uncircumcised person is to eat it. And you say, well, there's nobody here to do it. I know a couple of people that did themselves. Even that movie, that documentary called The Way. Get it. The guys, there's a lot of people. This one guy, he tells a whole story about him doing himself. I know another guy that used to come to this congregation. He did himself. I mean, that's hard. But if you know you're in disobedience for the Pesach, then do what you need to do. Do what you need to do. Bite a stick. You know, deal with the pain. Stop being a little girl and deal with the pain. Well, actually, girls are pretty strong. They give birth. Girls are pretty, you know, they go through a lot of pain each and every month. Men are mostly, can't do it. All right. Well, that's it for this teaching. I bid you an amen and an a curveball, man.
Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's bethgoyim.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's His loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and He's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let Him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift His face and shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you His shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area, come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. BGMC is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition
are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture, truly the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend the day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean, and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into his eternal word, not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of his kingdom become accessible to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close the Shabbat together with the reading of the new week's parasha. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.